Okay, everybody, we'll begin. You're very welcome to this afternoon's seminar in the Department of Sociology. Our speaker today is Ruth Rogers. Ruth is a reader in social justice and inclusion in the Research Centre for Children, Families and Communities at Canterbury Christchurch University. Her research explores youth and communities on the margins. She has researched the experiences of looked after children transitioning into becoming a care leaver, the impact of widening participation agendas on young people from private communities, and the ways in which official discourses problematise and manage certain social problems. The title of Ruth's talk today, as you can see there on the screen, is Instant Adulthood and the Transition of Young People Out of State Care. You're very welcome, Ruth.
Thank you. I'm going to try and keep an eye on the time, because this is something that I can unfortunately talk about for hours. I'll give you a bit of advance warning as well. It's a slightly depressing topic. I'm going to try and conclude with some sort of looking forwards and some positivity, but it's quite a difficult subject. So I'll just kind of crack on with it. So I've been doing research with looking at children for 10, 15 years. And what I'm going to talk about mostly is just a sort of collection of a whole series of research projects rather than one in particular. So it's a bit of a merge. The first half is really going to be talking about some data, so some statistics, what the situation is in England at the moment. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. The gender looked after children in England has been fairly consistent for quite a long time. I did look this up, it's very similar to Britain and Ireland as well. I think it's about 54% males in Ireland and about 46% females, so some similarities there. In 2016, there was a large increase in the number of unaccompanied asylum seekers in England, and these are generally older, so 16 plus. A male, and not surprising, in need because of absent parenting. And I'll talk a little bit about some of the reasons why young people come into care later on. But in terms of ethnicity, the majority is still white. And although the proportion of white looked after children has dropped slightly, 78-75%, and it's increased by Asian or other, still, only asylum seekers only make up about 6% of all children who are looked after in England. So, still, the majority is. So, it has changed, but I think the reason I'm saying this is I know the sort of media get quite excited about this and say that the reason we looked after children numbers have increased in England is because of the asylum seekers. They make up a very small proportion still. Sorry, that's a bit small. So the number of children in care by age. Again, there's a reason for putting this up. That's probably as far too small to sit back, isn't it? Okay, I'll just talk through it then. So the yellow, which is the by far the largest number, is 10 to 15 year olds. So this is a snapshot of children in care in England in 1918. So they, by far the largest proportion is children who are aged 10 to 15. I've got that in statistics, if it makes a bit more sense. So what we have is a pretty small proportion in blue of children under the age of one, that's 6%. 13% of one aged 1 to 4, 19% aged 5 to 9, and 39% are aged 10 to 15, 16% are aged 16 and over is 23% of the population. So this is still a sort of significantly higher proportion of 10 plus. And this is the age on starting. So they're all fairly equal, apart from those aged 10 to 15. So 19% of looked after children come into care under the age of 1, 18% aged 1 to 4, 18% aged 5 to 9. 28% 10 to 15, and 18% 16 and over. There are a number of different reasons for that, one of which is related to adoption, which has been another issue in England in recent years. And and lots of reasons why children come into care. There's a sort of misconception, I think, still, that children come into care because they're sort of bad and unruly. But I've got some sort of statistics on the legal reasons why children come into care. Now, there's a higher proportion aged 10 to 15, but still majority of children come into care because of abuse or neglect. That's coming up on the slide soon. So, just clip that up. So there's an increase in the number of looked after children. It's been increasing sort of significantly over sort of since back to 1994. It's just continuing on the increase. It's equivalent of roughly about 64 children per 10,000 are actually looked after. The average length of time they spend in care is also on the increase. It's average about 772 days. That's not just for 2018, of course. When I first looked at that, that can't be right, it's only 360. So that's the average time that a child spends in care during his life is 772 days, which is also on the increase. Okay, oh, that's lost all the data. Oops. Okay, not sure what happened then, apologies. Okay, I'll talk through this one. That's the only one that's happened to. Okay, so the red on the top is family dysfunction, and that is 16%. 16% of children come into care because of what's called family dysfunction. 8.6% is the grey, which is family and acute stress. And that could be acute stress, that could be a sort of fairly short-term issue, so that could be problems in the home, somebody's sick, sort of small family breakdown. 6.9% is absent parenting. Now, large numbers of those will be made up of unaccompanied asylum seekers. But the blue, which is 68.2%, is abuse or neglect. This data was a little bit problematic because, as you know, the tick box issues, social workers have to tick a box as to what the reason the child is what's their primary need. I think 68.2% for abuse and neglect I think it has to be taken with a bit of caution because there are so many variations on that. But even taking this into account, that's a significantly high proportion. There have been some other changes recently. That never had the data on, that's not missing. Sorry, that was taken from the DfB website. So I can talk to that. So there are other issues that are happening about the legal status of children. This is the reason, so we've got the reasons why social workers say they're going into care, but then there's the kind of legal policy or order for what's bringing them into care. Now you've got care orders, which is the blue right at the top. Our care orders will be, they're compulsory orders. They're often emergency. And there's a massive increase in the number of care orders in England. The second line is the voluntary arrangement. Now that's been on the increase. So that essentially what that means is that more children are being placed into care without parental consent than with parental consent. So there's an increase in the numbers going in where parents aren't consenting. There's a decrease where parents are consenting. With parental consent, I think they do tend to be with the older age group as well. Then the red is placement orders and freeing orders. A placement order is the order that social workers will seek to put a child up for adoption. So they also tend to be with the lower age group. Because a child's been given a placement order, it doesn't automatically follow that they will be adopted. So social worker will apply for a placement order and then they will look for an adoptive family. There have been lots of changes in England recently regarding adoption with fluctuations in the increases and decreases in the number of available adopters, fluctuations and decreases in the number of children who have a place with water. And a huge media campaign 7 years ago to recruit adopters, which was perhaps problematic, shall we say, because lots of adopters who were recruited were wanting to adopt babies, so I think there were some issues over expectations because an unappreciation of the fact that a lot of, for a start, there were few babies who needed adoption, and secondly, there were a lot of children who were being placed for adoption but had very, very severe needs and challenges and difficulties, and the adopters weren't qualified or willing to be able to take on those children. This one is about adoption. So this is looked after children who were adopted. In 2017, children looked after were adopted, which has decreased by 13% in 2018. But you can see the decrease started in 2015 quite significantly, with 5,360 children adopted in 2015 to 3,820 adopted, 3,820 in 2018. If you look at those figures, bear in mind the increase in the number of children coming into care and the decrease in the number of children adopted, it sort of highlights one of those significant mismatches that was taking place. There was also a case back in 2013 where there was an order by Judge Mumby, who said that he argued that social workers were looking to adoption too soon, and that the first port of call should be to see if there were family members who could adopt the child or who could be placed with. And this led to a massive reluctance in social workers to actually apply for placement orders. So this is one of the reasons why we've seen this decline. Oh, it's lost all those again. I'm sorry. This was. Wonder how many of these have gone. I checked this before I left, and they're all there. So I think it's lost something in the connection. I can send a lot of the slides to you. Apologies. So, the place we've looked after children. You've got 74% in blue. So 74% of looked after children are in foster care. Again, I think that's a similar figure in Ireland. I did have a quick look, and the recent figures I could find quickly was 2016, which said that about 89% of your children are in foster care. But of those, about 21% are placed with relatives. So that was interesting. Then the red is, see if I can read this myself, is 3%. So it's 3% who are placed for adoption. Placement with parents is 6%, and that's the grey one. The yellow one is 4%, and that's other placements in the community. Grey is 11%, which is secure units for children. So that's going to be when there's sort of health issues, largely, but also lots of children's homes. And then finally, the 2% is mother and baby units, residential care homes, and young families institutions. Okay, so now to the next bit. I'm glad that one's still where it is. I tried to sort of pivot this around as well, so it was by age, but every time I did it, it sort of did it by sort of the significant numbers, so sort of try to make sense of that. But what we're essentially saying is that 31% of looked after children in England leave care on their 18th birthday. Only 0.2% of our children leave care after the 18th birthday, which I think is a horrifying figure. This is also children leaving care on their 18th birthday is actually up from 22% in 2014. So it's up from 22% to 31% leaving on their 18th birthday. Over the same period, the number of children aged 1 to 4 leaving care fell since 2014, but that corresponds to the issues we've had of adoption. So there's reduction in placement orders, reductions in adoptions. there's a reduction in the proportion of children aged 1 to 4 who are leaving care. Okay, so outcomes for care leavers. I think one of the things about the outcomes that I'm not talking about that much today is that looked after children are also far less likely to achieve academically whilst they're in care. I'm not talking about individual cases, I'm talking about statistically. And there's a whole range of reasons for this. You've got significant placement moves, you've got moves to different schools, you've got sort of the emotional turmoil of all those consequences. But as well as being disadvantaged whilst in care, these disadvantages continue long into adulthood. This data is where the local authorities are actually in touch with their care leavers. Now, local authorities are expected to stay in touch with the care leavers and provide support for them. And it's a statutory obligation, it's not supposed to be optional, they're supposed to be doing this. But to be counted as in touch, all they have to do is be in contact with the local authority has to be in contact with the young person around 3 months before and 1 month after their birth. So it's fairly light in touch. And this data is only taken for is taken off the proportion of care leavers who local authorities are in touch with. So this could just be a phone call. So what you've got here is, in 1918, only 76% of 17-year-old care leavers will have been in touch with the local authority. It increases with the older age group, largely because the data was a bit experimental for 17-year-olds. But still, 19 to 21-year-olds, only 88%, have had any contact with their social workers or with social services around their birthday. There was a move in recent years to give care leavers the option to stay put with their foster carers, so to continue to live with their foster carers. It was imaginatively titled staying put. It was a nice bold move, but it was only measured at 3 months. So the idea, if you stay, you'd officially left care, but you could continue to live with your foster carer. And it was very welcomed, but there wasn't significant take-up for this. One of the reasons is that although you could continue to live with the foster carer, you still move to adult services. So at 18, you still have a different social worker, you still have, the system is completely different. There was often a reluctance from foster carers to continue to care for their looked after children, not because they instead didn't want to care for that particular child, but because of all the bureaucracy and the sort of changes and their financial implications, etc. So it's fairly low take-up, unfortunately. So, activity of care leavers. One of the things that frustrates me, not just as a human being, but as a researcher, is that the reality is we don't know, we really don't know how many looked after children, how many care leavers go to university. They are estimates, they are only ever estimates. And it's taken from two things, this in touch that social workers are supposed to be able to do. So that's just a snapshot. So are you in university now? Yes, but they might not be in a week's time. And we have on the UCAS forms, students can say that they spend time in care, but it's very, very low take-up. I'm not sure, it may have changed now, but it used to be next to the, do you have any special education needs, and have you spent time in care? So there's kind of reluctance on young people to tick this. And also a lot of European students would tick it because they were going to be living with foster families, so they didn't quite understand. So it was a bit of a mess. But in addition to this, where has it gone? If you put the age groups together, it's an average of 6% of care leavers are in university. Well, that's bad enough. What we don't know, we have absolutely no way of finding out what proportion of these care leavers continue with their course, what proportion to finish, what sort of, how do their awards compare with others? Just don't know. Okay. Um, always through the, but almost through the data section. So accommodation for care leavers. So we've got, it speaks for itself, doesn't it, really? Only 67% of 17-year-olds were in accommodation considered suitable. 17-year-olds, 43% return to live with parents. That doesn't necessarily mean that they've gone back home to a secure place. 9% were in transitional accommodation. That could be bed and breakfast, that could be sofa surfing. And 9% were in custody, 17-year-olds. 23%, we don't know. For 18-year-olds, the proportion who remained with their parents had dropped from 43% to 12%. Now, there may be natural reasons for that. It may be that that's indicative of it just not working out. Okay. So, adult outcomes for care leavers. 2018, looked after children who have been looked after for at least 12 months are 5 times more likely to offend than all other children. Interestingly, despite this, the proportion of those who have committed offence once they make the transition out of care is even higher. The trajectory continues. So although they're more likely to commit crime, whilst in care, they're much more likely once they've left the care system. So 6% of male youths who have been looked after for a continuous 12 months have received a conviction or youth caution compared to 1% of the general population. It's quite old research, but the green one there is 2011. The HMIPs found 27% of young people in young living offending institutions they surveyed had previously been in care. 45% of females in young offending institutions had spent time in care. So surveys and estimates, but Centrepoint reported that 17% of the homeless people it works with have been in care. Not something to be proud of, but substance misuse. Again, this speaks for itself. 4% of children were identified as having a substance misuse problem. 46% have received an intervention for this. It's more common in males, more common in older looked after children, which is probably not a surprise. 4% of males compared to 3% of females. Okay, so to kind of relate this back to this notion of sort of child-youth transitions. Previously, we now understand youth transitions as being generally very reflexive and very adaptable. Historically, there was a sense that youth transitions were this very linear movement towards this very conventional goals, with unemployment being this key to adulthood. This linear notion of youth transitions is in part based on this very straightforward, one-directional understanding, which is education to employment. So you move from school and you move to work. Family of origin to family of destination. So you live with your family, and then you have your own family. Living with parents to living away from parents. The housing transition, so it's perhaps where you're physically living. Now, this is clearly not appropriate for the world we're living in at the moment. Instead, there's supposed to be very kind of distinct stages. So it's this separation, which is when the young person becomes detached from their key individual group. The second stage is margin, where the young person is sort of passing through this kind of cultural realm, where you have fewer of the old attributes of support and fewer of the new attributes of support. You're sort of in the interstages. And then aggregation, which is where the person returns to the state of stability. Significantly, it's this margin stage where the young person is said to fall into the sort of indices of social structure. It's during this time where the young person is particularly vulnerable. Their experience is characterized by a blurring of boundaries and the unreliable passing of responsibilities from one group to another. You have fewer socially recognized means of legitimating your stake in the social world. So now we have these fragmented youth transitions, which is, I'm sure, people are sort of very familiar with. You're increasingly interested in fragmented social and class trajectories, highly individualized trajectories. There was something on the news, I think, just yesterday or the day before that was suggesting that I think our brains don't mature until we're 30. So 26%, 20 to 34-year-olds were still living with their parents in 2017. 23-year-olds living with their parents rose from 37% to 49% between 2003 and 2017. 49% of 23-year-olds living with their parents. Now, I mean, I think there's lots of reasons for this. It's because of the awful housing market and the sort of rising housing costs and sort of the insecure employment market. So it's not to assume this is just because they're doing it because they want to, because I'm sure many of them wouldn't, and their parents. But then you've got this sort of consistent movement back and forth. And you know, there's arguments about adult behaviour is kind of a bit messy, a bit inconsequential. It's not until the young person enters the early 20s that these more sustained commitments begin to emerge. Whereas there's some previous transitional stages were considered to be constructively defined, and now we're guided much more by personal agency. But importantly, relating it back to this work, you know, this gradual and non-linear transition is a luxury that is not afforded to care leavers. The possibility of these adult futures is marked by this chronic and continuing exclusion. Which is where we are this, the instant adulthood. Despite all the things that we've talked about, the support for young people in the UK still tends to be abruptly terminated on their 18th birthday, and sometimes 16. There's some financial support with housing, particularly if young people are continuing with education, but I'm going to come on to some of the realities of that, because there's, one of the things I found is that there's a huge difference between what is supposed to be provided and what actually is provided in reality. Just to summarise some of the research that I've done over the last too long to remember, looking at the experiences of young people. Now, despite everything I've said so far, I'm predominantly a qualitative researcher. I just want to contextualise some of the key issues for you. In 2000, I've got the year 2002, but that can't be right. It might be. There was the target of increasing participation in higher education up to 50% in England, which had a particular focus on young people from non-traditional backgrounds. There's the ongoing issues that we've got at the moment with participation in higher education, particularly in England. You've got a lot of post-93 universities are really struggling to recruit. We've got a lot of more prestigious universities are struggling. Did I mention Brexit? You've got universities who have previously recruited lots of European students. They're now not recruiting European students. We've got English universities with 40% drop in student numbers. And what they're doing is they're lowering the tariff. So they are taking more of the students from the less prestigious universities. The less prestigious universities are then casting the net further afield, going to communities where they are traditionally not university. They're picking up some of the care leavers. But they're also picking up a lot of students who are not from a family that's maybe supportive of university. So there's a lot of scrambling going on. One of the things I found, the list of many things I found, is that there's a lack of clarity over who's responsible for looking after care leavers between agencies, and that's social services, that's local authorities, and that's the higher education and the further education colleges. There is support available from further education colleges and from universities. One of the key problems with that is that generally they don't know who their care leavers are. There's obviously importance, the care leaver said, talked a lot about the importance of a significant other, what they perceive to be a lack of care. And a lot of care leavers refuse support for complex reasons, quite justifiable complex reasons. So, I'm not sure, can you read that? No, okay, I'll get the slides. Okay, so what we've got is journal interviews with these are quotations from social workers. So during the interviews with social workers, there was lots of confusion. The first one says, I highlighted a student to the college to get some support, but I'm not sure how much support he got. He blew all his money and was constantly coming back to say he had no food. I haven't been very impressed by them because students drop out and I haven't seen the support is there. I might be highlighting people, but they still drop out, and then I get a phone call from the young person saying, can you sort out my accommodation? And that's a quotation from a social worker. That's quite a senior social worker. There were other senior social workers who were saying that FE colleges and universities have no responsibility over the accommodation of care leavers. That's the responsibility of social workers. So there's real confusion over who actually took responsibility. Sometimes it's the local authority who will then decide whether a child was in need. If the local authority said they weren't, if they were in need, then it's the social services' responsibility to care for them. But particularly in Kent, you've got something like 50% of the looked after children in Kent are not from Kent. So their social worker could be 100 miles away. The person they're seeing on a day-to-day basis is the support worker within the FE college. They're the person they're going to and they're asking questions of. So it must be quite difficult as a support worker in an FE college, and you've got somebody saying, I've got nowhere to sleep tonight, not to try and do something about it. I'm not sure if you can't see them. I'll skip to something that is a bit bigger, hopefully. There are many further education colleges and universities will provide some additional support to care leavers, and this includes things like ensuring they've got access to accommodation 365 days a year. So a lot of universities and university particularly they're closed at the same time. Their accommodation then gets some cleaned and sort of rented out. But ensuring that because if the young person's got nowhere to go, they can stay on campus. There's a whole lot of financial aid possibilities, budgets for or bursaries for computers, for laptop computers, all sorts of things. And the problem, which I'm going to come into, is that obviously if they don't know who the students are, then they can't offer this support. Okay, so let's talk a bit about what some of the young people have said to me. And there's few quotations on here, so hopefully you can hear them. Okay, young people described how they felt completely isolated. They were abandoned and in some instances betrayed by the caregivers. This was a particularly difficult interview to give. She's a young woman who was just really, really struggling. She was in FE college at this time. Although the vulnerability that she's describing is probably relatively common amongst a lot of young people who leave home for the first time, what we can't forget is that this is somebody who suffered from a highly disruptive and unstable background, deprived of the social and emotional support that many other young people have had. And she didn't have the option to go back home if it got too tough. She had nowhere else to go. I invited them to talk about what would have made it easier for them. And these were their answers. I think you need more help with just the emotional, psychological stuff when you're first moving on your own, just sort of checking in on you, giving you a call. This is from interviews with learning mentors in FE colleges. During interviews, student support staff from colleges spoke about what they considered to be very limited contact they'd seen their care leavers having with their social workers. And these findings have been supported by lots of other research as well, with students saying things like, I was in care for four times in the whole 2 years I was in care, I only got a phone call, you know, sort of once a month. And it was the FE colleges were really quite frustrated about this. They were desperately trying to set up meetings with the young people and with their social workers, and they were being cancelled, and they didn't feel that the young people were getting the support that they needed, and they didn't feel that they could step in to provide any support. There's some interviews with social workers. This was slightly at odds with the data generated from interviews with social workers, who said that they tried to contact care leavers once they start college. Or, I tried to make contact with them once a month or so in the early stages. But this social worker qualified this by saying, but we are short-staffed here. And she's right, they were very, very short-staffed, and they had huge caseloads. Another explained that they wouldn't contact the care leaver to find out how college course was going unless they knew there was a problem. And from those interviews, there was evidence to suggest a clear disparity between the nature and quality of personal contact social worker teams had provided young people with and the contact that the young people felt that they would have benefited from. So in addition to the concerns that the young people felt ungrounded and had been inadequately supported on an emotional level, they also described this profound sense of personal abandonment. They felt the support they received could be quite volatile, and that when their support did end, it was ended abruptly and prematurely. And linked to this, throughout this, was this sense that social workers, caregivers, did not have a personal investment in the young person. So, you know, while they expressed strong desires for support to be consistent, they felt that the support they received was often sporadic, it was unpredictable. They wanted the support you might get from a decent parent. And expressed a strong desire for carers, including foster carers and social workers, to persevere them. There was one particular young person who knew she was a pain. She knew she was a pain. She was absolutely clear about the fact that she was a pain. But she said that she got a constant sense that at any point, if she kicked off too much, they'd just kick her out. That would be it. And she saw her friends kicking off and not being kicked out. But for her, it was very contractual. Right, now this is going to be far too small for you.
Sorry, kicked out of where, obviously, out of... Where would they have been kicked out of if she kicked off?
They would have gone back to social work. Social workers would have found another placement for them, which could be anywhere. It could be in emergency B&B. It could be in another part of the county. This particular young person was from the West Country, and she was in Kent.
Yeah, why is that?
She could have been sent back to the West Country.
Why is there such a high percentage of abandoned children in Kent? Or why is Kent? Is it because of the port, or what's the drawing?
They have a lot of private foster carers. They have a huge number of private foster carers, and in places like London, particularly not Milton, come from London. There's London. They have a shortage of foster carers. So it's so I know you're not going to read this, I'm sorry. I'll read them out to you. So the first one is, somebody said, I felt kind of abandoned. My social worker took a back seat. The second one was particularly difficult. She said, the minute they dropped me off at college, that was it. I didn't hear from them again. I don't think it was them. I mean, I wasn't their kid. I wasn't their responsibility. This particular young woman had been with the same foster care from the age of 8 to 16. She went to college at 16, and that's what she was talking about her experience. She never saw them again at 16. And she'd been with them since she was 8 years old. And somebody said, I had a really rubbish social worker. She was a cow. She really was. She was horrible. She was meant to visit me every so often, and she told me that by law, she only had to have contact with me once every 6 months. So she said a phone call even counted. And then they were talking about the kind of the personal, rather than just someone who's got a job. That was the thing I always hated about being in care, was that you don't really care about me at all. This is just your job. you don't care if this happens to me, it's just your job, you get paid to do this, it isn't because you love me or you care. And then second from the bottom, this young man was saying that social services never once asked me what we're eating, what we did together, you know. They never asked me how I felt. They didn't get involved or check that I had support at home or school. I would have done much better and been much further along than I am if I'd been had better care. This particular young man had been removed from London at a young age and put in Kent, and was he was about nine when he went to, he was about nine when he went into care, and when he was 12, he was sent to Kent and tried to get through with in FE. And was particularly angry about it because he wanted to go back home. And then you've got, and I'm kind of running out of time now, and it's difficult because I've made this so small, the screen's so small, nobody can read it.
Mm-hmm.
I do. Can you read it? Okay. But this was the thing that I thought was really insightful, is that a lot of these young people were saying that they've been offered support. They've been offered support lots of times, and they said no, because they don't want support. They don't want the support you're offering. They don't want to be emotionally reliant on somebody else who's going to let them down. But what they didn't anticipate was that if they were offered support and they said no, that's it, the support is withdrawn. So, I mean, some of the, if you can read them, some of these were kind of quite clear. So this particular woman at the front, she said, I had an independence plan and they asked me if I wanted support for when I moved into shared accommodation. This is the same person who left at 16. Been somewhere since she was eight. Basically offered support for helping budgeting and cooking and blah blah blah. But at that age, I was like, no, I know how to cook. I don't need that. So I didn't accept it. So I literally ate toast and jam most days and make my housemates food. And you need someone just checking in every now and then, because this child who doesn't know their own mind, you know, because they're a teenager, rather than being like, well, they said they didn't want any help, so I'll leave them to it. And the last one I thought summed it up so beautifully. She says, "Yeah, I remember once I really needed to speak to my social worker about where I would be living, stuff like that. She came down with her husband and picked me up, drove to the university to pick up her daughter, and then took us all out for a meal, so I didn't really get to talk to her. So we were sitting there, and well, she had a lovely family all around her, and I didn't get a word in edgeways. And then as we're walking back to the car with her lovely family, she said, is there anything you need to talk to me about? And I was like, no. So I didn't want to talk to her in front of her family. She might not have seen a social worker for another 6 months. She might have got a phone call in a couple months' time. And you know, there was that real kind of sense that the support that they were given, that they wanted, the support that they were given was not the same as what they needed. And one of the things that I find, I'm kind of approaching the end now, thanks for your patience. One of the things that I did find quite different from the support that people were getting offered from social workers compared to the support that it was limited, but they were getting offered from universities and from further education, was because the numbers that the universities and further education were dealing with were so much smaller, they were able to offer more personalised support. And there were mentors saying things, you know, an FE mentor says, you know, one of my lads knew that if he's stuck at university, I'll be there at his graduation ceremony. It's important to be prepared for, really shouldn't be underestimated. You know, it's essential to development of resilience. But FE colleges and universities will still say the same thing, is that the problem we have is that we don't know who the care leavers are. And that's one of the biggest problems they have. There are possible changes now. I mean, there are kind of developing changes all the time. In Kent and the southeast of England, there's something called the Care Leavers Progression Partnership, which is a collective with six partner FE colleges and four universities in the southeast. It's small, but there are other things existing now across the UK. Which are talking about sharing good practice and sharing knowledge about how to actually access care leavers to provide them with the support that they need if they want it. There's the Frank Buckle Trust, which now provides, it's got 199 institutions who have signed up to the Frank Buckle Trust, sort of achieving a quality mark, which is about providing 52-week all year round accommodation. There are some FE colleges in the southeast that are actually providing driving lessons for young people, if they know who the young people are. So I'm just going to scroll back because I'll read that because it's far too small for anybody to see anyway. I'll just skip to the back. Okay, I'll just talk to that. So just summarising really, because I'm kind of run out of time, is that there's, you know, there's evidence that there's significant questions over the support that young people are getting, that young people need. And one of the things that could help to resolve this is about some shared responsibilities and information sharing. Universities increasingly in England are now very concerned about widening participation and widening access. If they're going to do that, then they need to be able to provide the support to the young people who are going on to their university degrees. And that could be about just sort of sharing information about the services that they can provide to the social workers, to the local authorities, so that the young people know who they are, should they want to access any of this. I've spoken to them for nearly 45 minutes, so I'll stop. I'm sorry.